But the kiddos can head on down for children's church if they want, and we'll send somebody to bring y'all up when we start doing all the singing at the end, all right? Thank you, Laura. I feel pretty cozy this morning. I'll go ahead and tell you, who's warm?
Yes.
But the fireplaces are fake. They're not putting out a light. I'm just saying, it's amazing thing. Can you turn the volume down on the video a little bit, please? I was completely gone for a while. There we go, that's good. All right, so I was just telling somebody a few minutes ago that this is a challenge Sunday for us. You know what the challenge is? To stay away. I mean, seriously, we've got pretty fires. We even have candles that smell like fire. That was really cool. I think that was your idea. And we brought our blankets to curl up in. I got mine, so I'm totally going to just have the excuse to kick back and be comfortable while I preach. Y'all just have to bear with me. Okay. I'm set. Not that I'm cold, but you know. So we were brainstorming. You know how last week we brainstormed about what hope was, right? I heard some really good comments. Last night, we were at a minister's dinner for Smoky Hill Association, and Nate Butler, he's our mission director, a member of the church, he was telling everybody how he had been to just the most amazing Advent service about hope. That it was just so impactful and it really touched him. It was the most amazing one he had ever been to. And I started to ask him, and then I stopped and started laughing. And I told him, I almost asked him where he went. I did. He was here, in case you didn't catch that. Oh my goodness, it was a long day. But we were brainstorming what is peaceful? What does peace look like? And then we came up with, you know, fireplaces and you know the warm fire, a hot drink, blankets. What does peace look like to y'all when you think about a peaceful situation?
Kids.
Amen. The kids asleep. You know, like elsewhere asleep or
no,
a sleeping child is a very good
thing. I mean, elsewhere now that they're teenagers too.
Yeah. So what else? What do you think of when you think of peaceful?
It's a rough day, but it's okay.
Okay.
Outside.
You like outside?
Too much.
I was thinking of calm lakes.
Oh. Preferably without hail and lightning, right?
Calm.
There's some stories there. Out in the woods, maybe in a deer stand.
Inside reading a book in a nice rain.
Ooh, that's nice. Kim and I, we always enjoyed sitting together in front of the fireplace and looking at our Christmas tree this time of year. Now, we don't have a fireplace anymore, but we still will sit there at night once the kids have gone to bed, because it's much more peaceful then. And we'll just look at our tree and remember. Those of you who don't know, our tree, we get ornaments based on memories and things we've done. So our entire tree is a big memory. And so we'll look at this and that, and it brings back instances in our lives, and we'll remember that and enjoy that. I think watching snow fall gently, not like Kansas blizzard, but a nice gentle snowfall when you know you don't have to go out, that's kind of peaceful. God was talking to us about peace as well. Isaiah 9, 6 through 7. You're going to be familiar with this one. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will rest on his shoulders. His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father. And what's the last one?
Supreme
Prince of Peace. And to the end, and there will be no end to the increase of his government or of his peace. Jesus is our Prince of Peace. And I say again, he's ours because the Bible tells us he was born to us. He was a gift. He is a gift to humanity given to us. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he what? He gave his son. The Prince of Peace given to us. But what does that mean? What does it mean that Jesus is the Prince of Peace? I have a short video here. I wanted to look at, to drive home this question for us and to help set the mood. I'm going to go ahead and let you know in advance, every word of this video is straight from Scripture.
One day we're in the field, Cain rose up against his brother Abel and killed him. What causes quarrels and what causes fights among them? Is it not this, that your passions are at war within you? You desire and do not have, so you murder. You covet and cannot obtain, so you fight and quarrel. If you bite and devour one another, watch out that you are not consumed by one another. From the least to the greatest of them, everyone is greedy for unjust gain. From the prophet to the priest, everyone deals falsely. They have healed the wound of my people lightly, saying, peace, peace, when there is no peace. We look for peace, but no good came, for a time of healing, but behold, terror. The way of peace they have not known, for the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. For we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, for he himself is our peace. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased.
Probably not exactly the message on peace you were expecting. I'm just taking a guess there. I mean, come on, if we're going to talk about peace, we're supposed to talk about, you know, that silent night. We're supposed to talk about peace in the world, and we pray for peace in our lives, right? We pray for an end to hostilities, to anger, to hatred. But that was really not even close to where that is going. That is not what you were expecting with our fireplaces today. Now here, I want you to understand, there's nothing wrong with wanting that kind of peace. The Bible even commands us to pray for that kind of peace in our lives. 1 Timothy 2, 1-4. I urge you that entreaties and prayers, petitions and thanksgivings be made on behalf of all men, for kings and all who are in authority. Why? So that we may lead tranquil and quiet lives, peaceful lives, in all godliness and dignity. And why do we pray for peace? Well, because this is good. Peace is good and acceptable in the sight of God, our Savior, who desires that all men be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. Worldly peace, that tranquil and quiet life, is a good, a good thing. And it is a good thing because it is in that sort of peace that we can best reason with people and proclaim the good news of Christ and share the salvation that is made possible through his sacrifice. But that is not the kind of peace that is meant by calling Jesus our Prince of Peace. Still, in this time of year, you'll find there are a lot of people who will go to various churches and they are looking for some peace, that worldly peace, that peace to get them through the next day, and that's okay. And maybe right now you're weighted down with things. You're weighted down with the pain and the struggles and the chaos of the world we live in, and you are looking for that kind of peace. I get it. Many of you who know me, you realize this time of year, I usually struggle with peace. I have seasonal depression, and this is the first year in a long time that I haven't been really struggling this time of year. I get it. That personal, that centered, calming peace that God made us want. I want to help us all find that. But before we can, I have to tell you, we cannot know that sort of peace by chasing after that sort of peace. You see, when the angels declared glory to God in the highest and peace and goodwill to those in whom with him God is pleased, they were not speaking of personal peace. They were not speaking of world peace. The glory and goodwill are the result of the peace made possible in Jesus Christ, peace with God. And it is only on the basis of peace with God that we can truly know peace within ourselves. And so today I hope to show you what that peace with God looks like and what it means and why in turn that peace with God can lead to true inner peace. That peace the Bible talks about that passes understanding. So I want to ask them, what is this peace with God that Jesus makes available to us, and why do we need it? But we need peace with God because God's anger, God's wrath over our sin, it's like the anger and wrath of a father who's given a few minutes of quality time with the person who abused their child. It's like that father who has the opportunity, and we're not talking about a good opportunity here, but he gets to be alone with the person who murdered his wife. God's wrath is like that, only way, way more. Nahum 1, 2 through 6 describes the wrath of God like this. The Lord is a jealous and avenging God. He is avenging and wrathful. This is not what you're used to hearing at Christmas, is it? The Lord takes his vengeance on his adversaries and keeps wrath held up for his enemies. The Lord is slow to anger and great in power, but he will by no means clear the guilty. God himself said that. You might remember in Exodus. We saw this just a little while ago. His ways are the whirlwind and the storm. The clouds are the dust of his feet. He rebukes the sea and makes it dry. He dries up the rivers. Carmel withers. The bloom of Lebanon withers. The mountains quake. The hills melt. The earth heaves. The world and all that dwell in it. Who can stand before his indignation? Who can endure the heat of his anger? His wrath is poured out like fire, and rocks are broken into pieces by him. Or if you want a New Testament picture, Revelation chapter 19, verse 11. And then I saw the heaven opened up, and behold, a white horse. And the one sitting on it is called Faithful and True. Who is it? It's Jesus. And in righteousness, he judges and makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire. On his head are many crowns. And he has a name written that no one knows but himself. He is clothed in a robe dipped in blood. And the name by which he is called is the Word of God. And the armies of heaven, lined up in fine robes, white and pure, were following him on white horses. From his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron. He will tread out the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God Almighty. Romans 1 tells us the wrath of God revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who by their unrighteousness suppress truth. And if you want to hear it straight from the mouth of our Savior himself, he said, do not fear the one who can kill you, who can kill your body, but not your soul. Fear rather the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. And friends, the irony there is the one who said it was the one who can do it. maybe you think of the idea of God's wrath as evil, as this just warped and demented Old Testament idea that has no place in the modern world. But friends, the fact that we can even think close to that, not that it's evil, but this idea that wrath is just so far away from our picture of God, is only because you and I in Jesus have learned of the love of God. We have tasted His grace, His peace, and we know God in a radically different way. But that doesn't change the reality of the Heavenly Father, who is righteously angry over the sin that is destroying His world, His people, you and I, made in His image. I'm not one to really preach fire and brimstone. I don't really go off on the wrath of God very often. But as we come today to this picture of Jesus, our Prince of Peace, we cannot understand that until we also are willing to come face to face and understand what the wrath of God is. We cannot understand the awesome gift we have in Jesus unless we understand the wrath we would face apart from Him. Hell is real. Judgment will happen. The seven bowls of wrath described in the book of Revelation are some of the most horrifying and scary stuff that you can read. And it's not like some kind of Hollywood horror flick. It is terrifying because it is real, and one day God will pour that wrath out over the world. And it is that wrath, that picture that the Bible describes, that is exactly in full measure what God the Father poured out on Jesus as He hung on the cross. Jesus faced the full wrath of God, and He paid for it in full with His own blood and life. He did so to cover the sins of every man, woman, and child forever. He took all of it. Through that sacrifice, He made peace with the Father. He made it so you and I can come before the holy and righteous One boldly, with joy, with hope and love, instead of trembling in fear. Romans 5 tells us, God shows His love for us in that while we were still sinners, while we were enemies of God, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by His blood, how much more will we be saved from His wrath? 1 Thessalonians 5 says, God has not destined us for wrath, but instead to obtain salvation through Jesus our Lord. Guys, our sin was great. If you haven't figured that out in your life yet, your sin in life is huge. We like to judge how sinful we are based on, you know, the people around us, and dude, man, I got way up on you, right? Right? No. God doesn't look at whether or not we're on a curve of how sinful we are compared to one another. He looks in the mirror, sees His perfect holiness, and then He looks at us, and you better pray He sees not one of us is holy and righteous compared to Himself. Our sin is great. God's wrath over that sin is great. But the grace that He offers in the person of His Son is greater. Say that louder. Amen. Amen. The grace given us in Christ is greater than all the sin in all the world in all time. That is why He is our Prince of Peace. That is why He rules over us in grace and kindness. Jesus, our head, our King. And under His government, we will never face the wrath of God. And if you don't say amen there, you're not listening. We have peace with God. Thank you. We have peace with God. The righteous, holy God of all creation has forgiven us and adopted us as his own children. He has made us his. Romans 8, 1 through 3. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. One of my favorite verses. Whenever I'm walking through life and things have me down and I look at myself and I'm like, what an idiot I am. I can't even go one day without just wading through sin. And God goes, there is no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, because it's weak through the flesh, that's us, God did it by sending his own Son as an offering for sin. In Jesus Christ, we have peace. We have perfect peace. We have eternal peace because we have peace before the wrath of God. And because of that peace, friends, we have hope. We have the hope of knowing that we have eternity with God, that he looks on us as his children and he is our perfect father. We can have joy, overflowing joy, because we know God and we don't have to look at him in his wrath and anger, his holiness as a condemnation on us. We look at God the Father and understand his love and seeing his love. We overflow with joy. And we can have that love as well. We are free in Christ to lavish love on people the same way that Jesus lavishes his love on us. In Jesus, we have peace with God. He is our Prince of Peace. And it is only from that peace that all the rest of everything flows. It is from the peace of God, the peace we have received and has been purchased by Jesus, that we find all the promises of God are yes. That's 2 Corinthians 1:20. In Jesus Christ, all the promises of God to us are yes. This promise is for you, he's saying. What promises do you hang on to? Here are a few keeping in our topic. John 16:33. These things I have spoken to you. Why? So that in me you may have peace. In the world you're going to find tribulation. That's true. But have courage. I have overcome the world. Philippians 4:6 through 7. Which we should just be honest. This verse makes no sense apart from Christ. You'll see what I mean. Here it is. Be anxious for nothing. In everything, by prayer, supplication, and thanksgiving, make your requests known to God. Why? Because the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Don't be anxious. Have you seen the world today? Have you seen my bank account and my schedule? And God says, guard your heart and your mind, your emotions and your thinking, your anxiousness and your worry. He will guard you in Christ Jesus. Isaiah, which go Old Testament, Isaiah 26:3, you will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. Not very peaceful today? Got some worries and anxieties? Biblically, God promises in Christ, keep your mind on him, trust in him, and he will keep you in perfect peace. You can't keep yourself in peace. You can worry about yourself not being in peace. I'm just so stressed out because I haven't got any peace. You're chasing peace. You're not going to get there. Trust in him, and he will keep you. Psalm 37. In a little while, the wicked man will be no more. You will look carefully for him, but he will not be there. But the meek will inherit the earth, and they will delight themselves in abundant peace. Where have I heard that meek inherit the earth been before? Oh yeah, Jesus! Yeah, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. He's quoting Psalm 37, and they will delight themselves in abundant peace. Psalm 85, I love this one. I found this one this week. I will hear what the Lord God has to say, for he will speak peace to his people, his godly ones. Oh, but please don't let them turn back to folly. Surely his salvation is near to those who fear him. That glory may dwell in our land. And here's the part which is beautiful to me. Loving kindness, God's love, and truth have met together. Like they're two separate people. They've come together and they've met. Righteousness and peace have kissed one another. It's that kiss of greeting, that kiss of peace. Very Middle Eastern idea here. And you have this picture between righteousness on one side and peace on the other. You have the holiness of God. The holiness of God that if we apart from Christ looked on would go, I am toast. The holiness of God and the peace of God with which I can look on him and say, Abba Father, have come together and they've shared a kiss of peace. And I tell you, that took me straight to John chapter 1. In the Word became flesh, right? He tabernacled, he dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory. The glory as the only begotten from the Father, full of what? Grace and truth. Amen. Grace and truth. Peace and righteousness. Loving kindness and truth. I mean, this is all woven through the entire Scripture. In Jesus, these two come together. God's righteousness and peace with God. That is a miracle. For the law was given through Moses, end of John chapter 1 there. But grace and truth were realized, were exegeted, were explained and lived out to us through Jesus Christ. Righteousness and peace greeted each other with a kiss in the person of Jesus. And because of that, we can enjoy this kind of peace. The peace where we gather up by a fire and have a nice warm drink. And the peace of good friendship and the fellowship we enjoy. The peace that this world offers at its best. We can enjoy that. We can know the peace that passes understanding. Because we know peace with God through Jesus Christ. Our Lord. The world seeks this kind of peace, and they find it in momentary times and fleeting instances. But in Christ, we may know this peace, independent of any earthly circumstances. We have the peace of God through the person of Christ, our Prince of Peace. Let's pray.